elementary school is doing a food drive, specifically cereal. We are collecting cereal boxes during the month of March that will be donated to area food banks and food boxes around the community. And we are setting up a domino maze that hopefully will run up and down all of the hallways at the school. So the kids are real excited to see how long the trail we can get and how many cereal boxes we can get to those in our community that are in need. So if you want to bring cereal boxes, you may drop them off here and I will collect those throughout the month of March. Thank you.
Awesome, Casey. Thank you so much. It's called the Domino Effect of Kindness. And the school is just right down the street, so I highly encourage you to bring in boxes of cereal. Those of you with young kids, hey, go to the grocery store and have them pick out a box of cereal and let them know that it's for somebody else in the community so we can make a difference right here where God has placed us. Bring those boxes of cereal in. Yes, Karen.
I want to remind everybody that next Thursday night is our next kind of fellowship supper. We had 7 people come last month, which was wonderful. We had a wonderful discussion and good food. And remember, you just drop in, 6 at night. Yeah, Robert?
Wednesday night.
Oh, Wednesday night. What did I say? It's Wednesday night. So if you don't have anything in your refrigerator, but you drive up all month or something, just come anyway, because we've got plenty of food. And we just love and have people
to
get to know each other.
Is that this Wednesday night or the fall?
This coming Wednesday night.
This coming Wednesday night.
Wednesday of the month.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Perfect. Sounds good. Good announcements. Yes.
I'd like to ask for prayers for Sherry's and my mutual friend who lives in Nova Scotia. Annie has bladder cancer, liver cancer, and lung cancer, and she's on palliative care now.
Any other announcements? Yes.
I will tell you, I'm the mouthy one. I will tell you something. Some back months ago, I can remember telling the congregation, which were very few at that time, that I saw this church full. And I just about can't tell it now without crying. Because I'm seeing God answering prayer. He's good at it. Hallelujah. I ignore him sometimes, but he keeps getting my attention.
That's right. You know, Jesus says, you do not have because you do not ask. Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everybody who asks receives, and those who seek find. You want a full church? Pray. See what the Lord is going to do. We need to be faithful to what he is calling us to do as his people, as his bride. Love him and love one another. You just never know what God is going to do. So we walk by faith, not by sight, trusting and the Lord and what he's calling us to do. Any other note? Yes?
I want to be sure and welcome all of Suhei's family today. Our prayers have been with all of you.
Definitely welcome. We're very sorry for your loss. Jesus is there with you. All you are going through, the challenges, the difficulties, and the grief. Yet we know that we do not grieve as people without hope. We have our hope in the resurrected Christ. And we know that brings us comfort in the midst of our grief. Any other announcements? I'd like to remind everybody that the session has hired me as your interim pastor for at least the next year. However, the presbytery has to approve the contract between us. And the Committee on Ministry is not meeting until March 14th, so that means I cannot officially start as your pastor until the 15th. And March 19th will be my official first Sunday, and my family will be here as well that Sunday, so I'll have an opportunity to meet them. And I saw it in the bulletins, there's also going to be dinner and entertainment on March 24th at 5:30, Italian buffet, entertainment. It's going to be an awesome time. Sign up, and my guess is there's going to be sweet tea, right? Because I'm from California, and what I've learned is you guys really love your sweet tea here, wherever it is, so I'm adjusting to that, barbecue, all these different things that you have here as well. So I hope that you will be here, my family will be here as well, and even though I'm not starting officially for another week and a half, my email and phone number is here in the bulletin. So please do not hesitate to reach out to me at any time. I've already met with some of you. I have other meetings scheduled for this week as well. And I'm really looking forward to getting to know each and every single one of you, how God has been at work in your hearts and your lives. And we are going to be doing life together as a family on mission to what God is calling us to do. So I'm so glad that all of you are here this morning. And I'm looking forward to what God has in store for us as well. Are there any prayers of the people that we want to offer up now that have not already been voiced?
Prayers for a good friend of ours, Gail Miller. She had a heart attack.
Cindy, Colleen, ER, is blind and COVID. You all.
Okay. Any other prayers to the people?
Eddie Rollins couldn't be here.
I will also continue the prayers for my daughter as she faces medical issues this week.
All right. Let's pray. Lord, we come before you in gratitude and thankfulness for who you are, for what you have done in our lives and for what you are doing. And we know that you are not a God who is distant or far off, but a God who has come near to us in Jesus. And you understand everything that we are going through in life. So I'm praying, Lord, for your comforts and your hope and your healing in each and every single one of these situations that have been lifted up where people need the hope and healing of Jesus. So do what only you can, Lord. Lord, thank you for loving us, for doing for us what we can never do for ourselves, and for the privilege we have to come to you in prayer, offering up our hearts, desires, our struggles, our joys, our celebrations. We bring them all to you, knowing that you are not just the God who is for us, but a God who is with us at all times, in all places, in all circumstances. God, we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us sing. Says this: give me a sign of your goodness, that my enemies may see it and be put to shame. For you, O Lord, have helped me and comforted me. And that's what I'm really praying for each and every single one of us here this morning, that we would experience a sign of God's goodness. Have you ever prayed for that? Have you ever said, Lord, give me a sign of your goodness? When's the last time you asked the Lord for it? He's a good, good father, and he wants to give good gifts to his children, so ask him. And so that's what I've been praying for this service. That God would give each and every single one of you here in this room a sign of his goodness. Somehow, in some way. through prayers that are offered, through songs that are being sung, through scriptures that are offered, through communion that we take together, through fellowship time after service, whatever it is, I'm just praying that as we come to worship this morning, that you would all experience a sign of God's goodness in a fresh, new, and creative way through the Spirit of the resurrected Christ this morning.
Please join us in singing hymn number 515. Please stand.
King, you are forgiven. Be filled with spiritual wisdom. Lead lives worthy of your calling. Bear fruits in all you say, do, and think. God has rescued us and redeemed us from our sins, setting aside judgment to shower us with mercy. You are forgiven and free. Amen. Now let us take a moment to pass the peace of Jesus to one another and welcome each other into this space.
We are one.
Lord, I pray that that would be so, that we would all be reminded that we are one in you and your Holy Spirit. And I know that's what Jesus prayed for in John 17, that the world would know that we are your followers, based on how we love one another and how we're one in you and your love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, this morning I'm going to begin a short two-week series on the topic of forgiveness. And you may see in your bulletins there's this insert, and there are pens, pencils in the pews for you as well to follow along if you would like to fill in the blanks. Today what I want to talk about are the four myths of forgiveness. We'll get to that in a moment. Our scripture for these next 2 weeks is Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 through 15. It says this: "Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace and be thankful." It's interesting how at the end the Apostle Paul says, "Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace." And what's the key to experiencing the peace in our community and in our hearts? What he is talking about is in the verses before it. When we clothe ourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, patience, when we bear with one another, when we forgive one another, when we give grace to each other, then we experience the peace of Jesus. You know, what's interesting is the Apostle Paul, when he writes his letters to churches, he always starts off by saying grace and peace. Never peace and then grace. It's always grace first. You know why? Because the grace paves the way for the peace. Without the forgiveness, without the mercy, without the compassion, there can be no peace. And Jesus is the Prince of Peace himself. And that's why it's so radically important for us as human beings, for us as followers of Jesus, for us as the church, as the people of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, to be known as people who are forgiving. Because we have been forgiven by God for all of our sins, past, present, and future. God has forgiven us, and so therefore we are called to forgive one another. What I want to talk about this morning are those four myths, lies oftentimes that we believe or that we hear that prevent us from coming to that place of forgiving people in our lives. And the first myth or lie is that forgiveness is forgiving. Forgiveness is not always forgetting. In fact, it's just not possible. And I'll prove it to you. When I was 10 years old, I was playing basketball with some friends of mine down the street from my house. And as we were playing, all of a sudden, one of my friends, Angelo, goes over to another one of my friends, Brandon. And he whispers something in his ear. I don't know what it was. And then, after this brief conversation, Brandon went over to a pile of rocks, and he picked one up. And he came at me with the rock, like he was going to throw it at me. And so I got scared, right? And I started running up the street. And Brandon is chasing me. And as we're running up the street, he throws the rock as hard as he can at me. And he hit me in the back of the head right here. fell down on the ground, and I put my hand on the back of my head, and I brought it down, and it was just covered in blood. I went home, got all cleaned up with my mom and everything. I was 10 years old. I'm 42 now. And you know what? Every time I go back to see my parents, I have to drive past that place where Brandon threw the rocket and hit me in the back of the head 32 years ago. And guess what? I still remember it like it was yesterday. Have I forgiven Brandon for the wrong that he did to me and how he betrayed our trust as friends and hurt me and wounded me? Yes. I have forgiven him, but I remember. You're going to remember too. In fact, in some ways I have found that the memory is a gift from the Lord. You know why? Because I know how it felt to be betrayed by a friend. I know how it felt to be wounded. And so therefore, I don't want to do that to anybody else. Because I know what that feels like. I don't want to do that to a friend. I don't want to do that to anybody else because of the woundedness and the pain that comes with it. We are called to forgive. But it doesn't mean that you're going to be able to forget. We're not, as human beings, wired that way. That's just not how it works. But God is. What did the scriptures say? I am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake and remembers your sins no more. For I will forgive their wickedness and will remember their sins no more. This is one of the things that makes God so different from us, is that God can forgive our sins and they're cast into the deepest sea. He remembers them no more. And we try to bring them up and hold that guilt and that shame there within ourselves. And God says, what are you talking about? When he looks at you, you know what he sees? He sees his beautiful masterpiece, and he sees Jesus. The shed blood of Jesus on the cross covers your sins. And so when God looks at you, you are as pure as his son, Jesus. You are forgiven and you are free. And he remembers your sins no more. And we are called to forgive one another. And don't believe the lie that just because you can't forget what was done to you, that that's an excuse of why you can't forgive. You can forgive and remember and still live in a new way that God has for you. Don't let that be a barrier. Put it in its place. Let it be a gift. Forgive. Move on to the new thing that God has for you. Another myth is that forgiveness is excusing the other person's actions. Sometimes you believe, well, if I forgive that person, then that means what I'm saying is that what they did to me or what they said to me or my family member or my friend, it was okay. It was justified. No, it's not. Because you have to remember that forgiveness is not for the other person. It's not about them. Forgiveness is for you. Forgiveness is for your healing. Forgiveness is for your freedom. Forgiveness is for you to be set free. It's not about excusing the other person's actions or justifying it. No, there are consequences. It is simply about you being set free from that anger, from that vengeance, from that hatred, from that keeping a record of wrongs that you have. You want to be set free from it. Because in forgiving, what you are really saying is, I am no longer going to allow what this person did to me or said to me or about me or my family member or friend, I am not going to allow that to define and to control who I am any longer. I will not give them that power over me. I will not let them define that. I will allow my Heavenly Father to define my identity and my worth and my value as His beloved, just as Jesus came up out of the baptismal waters and said to His Son, "You are my beloved whom I love, and with you I am well pleased." And we will allow our identity to be shaped and formed and molded by the voice and the truth of our Heavenly Father, not the lies that somebody else may have said to us or about us or whatever it may be. That will not define us. We will be set free from that so that we can live into the new reality that God has for us in the future and to be all that God has called and created us to be, and we will not be shackled to the past any longer. You want to be free, don't you? Isn't that what you want for your kids? Isn't that what you want for your grandkids, your great-grandkids? You want them to live in freedom. You want them to live in hope. You want them to live in wholeness. You want them to live with joy and peace in their lives. It comes through forgiveness. It's not excusing the other person's actions. It's setting yourself free. That's what the scriptures say in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. What the scriptures say, it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. And that's what Jesus did. He set people free by forgiveness through offering Himself up for us all so we could have a right relationship with God. And He modeled for us the way that we can be in community with one another and have the peace of Jesus dwell in this place in a powerful way, so there can be healing and freedom in this place as well. That's what God wants for us. Don't believe the lie that forgiveness is excusing the other person's actions, but allow that to prevent you from doing what God is calling you to do. Oftentimes, we also believe this myth that forgiveness is staying in a toxic relationship. No, it is not. You can forgive somebody, but it doesn't necessarily mean that you need to stay in that relationship with them. Whether it's a marriage relationship, a friendship, whatever it may be. Because the situation has become so far gone, because of abuse, physically, because of verbal abuse, or whatever it may be, where the relationship has gotten to a point where, yes, you need to forgive them for your own healing, for your own hope, for your own freedom, and what God wants to give you in that moment, but it doesn't mean you stay in the relationship. In fact, sometimes God calls us out of those toxic relationships because He wants to use you as a witness and a testimony against them. In Mark chapter 6, Jesus sends out the disciples. And these were His instructions. Take nothing for the journey except a staff. No bread, no bag, no money in your belts. Wear sandals, but not an extra tunic. Whenever you enter a house, stay there until you leave that town. And if any place will not welcome you or listen to you, shake the dust off your feet when you leave as a testimony against them. Sometimes in life, you have got to shake the dust off your sandals and walk as a testimony against them. Those are not my words. Those are Jesus' words. And there were plenty of times when Jesus, in obedience to the will of His Heavenly Father, said, "I gotta go. It's time to get out of this town. It's time to get out of this relationship. It is toxic. It is not helpful. It is not beneficial." And yes, He loved them unconditionally, and He died for their sins, and He would pray for them, but He wasn't going to stay in the relationship with them. Sometimes God wants to use our removing ourselves from a relationship to bring conviction into the hearts and the lives of other people so that they will repent. Remember, the word repentance does not mean changing your behavior. When we hear that word repentance, we think, well, it's behavior modification. I'm doing this action, and now I stop doing it. No, that's not what repentance is. The word repentance literally means to rethink. Because you're not going to change any action in your life unless your mind changes first. See, the battleground to hearing the Lord is the mind. I think there's so much in Scripture about the transformation of our minds and having the mind of Christ dwelling in us richly and taking every thought captive for Christ. This is where it starts. And so maybe removing ourselves from a relationship will cause that person to repent, to rethink about the actions that they have been taking, about the choices they have been making. And maybe it won't. That doesn't matter. That's not on you. It's about you being faithful to what God is calling you to do. Because remember, you dance for an audience of one. Jesus did. Therefore, we must as well. So yes, we are called to forgive, but that doesn't always mean you're going to stay in a relationship that's toxic. And that's part of our prayer life and discerning, Lord, are you calling me to go or to stay? But once you make the decision to go, you go. You don't look back. You move forward. That's what Jesus did. That's what the disciples were called to do. And that's what we're called to do as well. And the final myth that we oftentimes believe is this. Forgiveness is easy. You know, people say, well, why don't you just forgive them? I mean, come on. Yeah, right. People don't always know the depth and the pain and the hurt that comes from people's actions. It's not easy to forgive. Not some flippant decision that just happens overnight. Luke 23:33-34. When they came to the place of the skull, they crucified him there, along with the criminals, one on his right and the other on his left. And Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. Do you think for a minute that it was easy for Jesus to utter those words from the cross as he's dying an innocent victim of other people's sins? He has done nothing wrong. He is perfect in every way, shape, and form. He's like us in every way except sin. And when you're on a cross, you know, it's incredibly hard to breathe. Because gravity pulls your body down and hands are above your head, so you have to push up on the nail to get high enough to take a breath. So not only is it incredibly hard to breathe, it's even harder to speak. Which is why Jesus is on the cross for 6 hours. If you put all the gospel accounts together, he utters 7 statements in the space of the 6 hours. That's it. That's all he has the strength. That's all he has the stamina to do, because he's just trying to breathe and stay alive. And yet one of the statements is, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. That was not easy for Jesus to do in that moment. But he chose it. Because it's love. Right? That's what the scriptures say in Colossians. That we're called to forgive, and all these virtues put on love, which binds them together in perfect unity. And the scriptures say that God is love. And so Jesus is loving his enemies to the very end. And he is lifting them up in prayer, asking that his heavenly Father would forgive them as he's dying on the cross for for their sins in that moment. That was not easy. But his Heavenly Father gave him the strength that he needed in that moment to do it. It's not going to be easy for you to forgive whoever it is that has wounded you, that has hurt you, and you carry that grief in your heart. But it's what God is calling us to do, so that we can truly heal, so we can truly move forward. And maybe the person you need to forgive is in this room. I don't know, I mean, you've all been doing life together for quite some time. You've been through a lot of struggles and difficulties and challenges, even in the midst of the joys and the celebrations and the wonderful things that are happening. The church is a family, and sometimes families fight. And sometimes there's woundedness there. God understands. He's with you in that. And he feels your pain, and he feels your hurt, and he feels your woundedness, and he has given you a way for healing to occur. And for whatever was said, whatever was done, whatever is there, I just want to say to you, I'm sorry. I'm sorry for that woundedness. I'm sorry for that pain. I'm sorry for that hurt. Sometimes people just do things to us in life, and it's not our fault. Things happen to us. And so we have a choice in how we're going to respond. We can choose to become better, or we can choose to become bitter. You know what God wants for you in your life? You know what he wants for his church, for his bride, for his people? He wants us to become better. And I know that's what you want too. And one of the ways that we become better and live in harmony with one another is through forgiveness. Receiving God's forgiveness and grace in our own lives. Forgiving ourselves the things that we have done. I have regrets in my life. There are things that I have done, that I have said, that I wish I never would have done or said. But I have to receive the grace and the forgiveness of God in my own life for that. And you need to as well. And then we need to walk in the courage of giving that away to other people. Because otherwise, we will be a slave to the past, and we will never be able to live in the freedom of the fullness of the future and the resurrection and the hope that God has for us and our lives individually and this church. When you are driving a car, what's bigger? The rearview mirror? Or the windshield? The windshield. Why? Because what is in front of you is more important than what's in the past. The rearview mirror is there, and you check it from time to time. And hopefully we learn from the past, and the mistakes that we have made, and the grace of God that was present there for us, even in the midst of it. But what's in front of us is far more important than what lays behind. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, to give you a future and a hope, not a past. God wants to move us into a new reality and a new beginning, and that can't happen as long as we're constantly looking at the rearview mirror. What does the scripture say in 1 Corinthians 13? Love does not keep a record of wrongs. God does not keep a record of wrongs. We must not either. They must be erased. And it happens through forgiveness. It's the only way. In the book of Genesis, Lot and his wife were fleeing Sodom and Gomorrah. And the scriptures say that at one moment, as they were fleeing the city, shaking the dust off their sandals as a testimony against them and going into a new reality that there was a moment where Lot's wife stopped and she looked back at Sodom and Gomorrah. And you know what the scriptures say happened to her? She was turned into a pillar of salt. You know what that says to me? As long as we are looking back, we will be crippled. We won't be able to move because we're stuck always looking back at what happened or what used to be. Our identity has to be in Jesus. We can't be caught up in the past. It has to be caught up in the God of the present, in the God of the future, in the God who wants to bring healing into our hearts, in our lives, and in our faith communities. And it happens when we do the hard work of forgiveness. And we heal, and we're unified, and we're one in Christ and His Holy Spirit, and then we don't look back, and we move. It's a new day. It's time for resurrection. Remember, the only way to resurrection is through the cross. It's not resurrection and then cross. Wilderness, journey, and then the new day. The land flowing with milk and honey. And I believe that that's what God has in store for you in your life, and for your family, and for His church, for this church family. I feel it. And I am so grateful and thankful to the Lord that He sent me and my family all the way from California here to be with you for such a time as this. When I moved here with my family in November, I didn't even know Madisonville existed. But I didn't need to know. You know why? Because God knew. And we walk by faith, not by sight. And we dance for an audience of one. He knew that we needed each other for such a time as this. So let us move forward together as a family, listening, caring, being people who are known for compassion and grace and mercy, and who will have an eye outside of the walls of this church toward our neighbors, loving and forgiving, doing what God is calling us to do. It's a new day. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for the example that we have in Jesus of what true freedom looks like. As we want to live in love, as we want to live in forgiveness. And thank you for the forgiveness that you pour into our lives individually, that we also desperately need. God, thank you for your unconditional love for every single person in this room and outside. God, we love you and thank you for this opportunity to worship you in spirit and in truth, and now to take communion together as a faith family. In Jesus' name we pray. Ordinarily at this time in the service, there would be our affirmation of faith, but since we're doing communion, this is our affirmation of faith, right here before us. This meal of the bread and the juice, reminders. These are visible signs of the invisible grace of God that captures us in our lives, in our hearts. And so on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he gathered around the table with his friends. Remember, in Psalm 23, it says, "You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies." You know what's interesting? Is that when the scriptures were written, you would never sit at table or dine with an enemy. You would only dine with friends. They were the only ones who were welcomed around your table. So, when David says, "You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies," what he's saying is, invite your enemy to the table, and in doing so, the relationship will be transformed, and they will no longer be an enemy. Let them sit and dine with you. Let there be forgiveness. Let there be grace. Let there be mercy, so that your enemy will become your friend. You dine together. This table before us is a place of healing. It is a place of reconciliation. It is a place of forgiveness. And remember, I am not the host of this table. This is not my table. It's Jesus' table. And he says every single one of you are welcomed to his table of fellowship. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. You are all welcomed to Jesus' table, because he says so. So on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, he broke it, and he offered it to the disciples to eat, and he said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you." And you, and you, each and every single one of you, the bread is now going to be passed out to all of you. The elders are coming. I want you to just take the bread and hold it in your hands. And as you get it, pray. This is coming to you. Thank the Lord for his forgiveness. Thank him for his grace. Thank him for his mercy. And maybe if there is somebody that God is putting on your heart that you need to forgive, as hard or as difficult or as challenging as it may be, pray that God will give you the courage to forgive them in your heart. So as you receive the bread, sit with Jesus and pray and feel his presence with you right where you sit. just the right amount. Take, eat, and do so, remembering Christ. And in the same way, our Lord took the cup and he poured it. And he offered it to the disciples to drink. And he said, take, drink. This is the cup of the new covenant. It is my blood shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. And as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the saving death of the crucified and risen Lord until he comes again. Jesus said this is the cup of the new covenant. And what makes it new is that the old covenant was just for the Jews, but the new covenant was for everyone. Young and old, rich and poor, black and white, male and female, educated, uneducated, it didn't matter. This cup, this table, Jesus' message, his way, is for everyone, because we all need it. The cup is now being passed out to you. Take it, hold on to the cup. And as you receive it, pray and thank the Lord for the shed blood of his Son on the cross that wipes away and covers all of your sins as a gift of his presence here with you. Take, drink, and do so in remembrance of Christ. Right? Lord, thank you for being the host of this meal, and that we can take it together as a faith family. Thank you for bringing us together here this morning to worship you in spirit and in truth. Thank you for your power and your presence and your Holy Spirit that's moving powerful ways in this church. May we continue to be open to ride the wave of the Holy Spirit as you lead us and guide us. God, we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. stand as we sing together. Church and what God is calling us to do and be about as we share the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ and his forgiveness with a world who desperately needs that hope.
Thank you.
pray. Lord, I thank you for what has been given. Sacrificially and with joy, as we know the scriptures say that you love a cheerful giver. And we give out of sacrifice and we give out of thankfulness for who you are and what you have done in our lives. We want as many people as possible to hear, know, and experience the unconditional love, mercy, and forgiveness that you have for them. So may this offering be used to advance your kingdom here on earth as it is in heaven. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us sing together. Website. We've been working really hard trying to update everything there, make it as current and welcoming and inviting as possible. We'll continue to make updates and add new pictures as time goes on as well, because God is on the move. And if we're not moving forwards, we're moving backwards. So let's continue to move forward into what God has in store for us. And as we began our time this morning, I read from Psalm 86, verse 17, which says, "Give me a sign of your goodness." And the sign of the goodness that God gave me this morning was simply being here with all of you. Amazing, Jesus-loving people who want to love God, who want to love people, who want to make a difference right where God has placed you. You are all a blessing to me in my life. Even though many of us are strangers, we have become friends. We have become family, and it's the love of God that unites us all to one another. And so as we go out into God's creation, may we continue to look for signs of God's goodness that he wants to shower upon us as his children, because he is a good, good Father. Amen?
Amen.
Go in peace. Love well.